do the same analysis now for KwaZulu-Natal, South Africa, where HIV prevalence exceeds 40%. I can again draw the probability tree where the probability of the disease is now 40%. And probability of no disease or no HIV is 60%. If we assume a test with similar accuracy, the probability of a positive test result, given that a person has a disease, again, this is known as a sensitivity, is 0.991. Hence, the probability of a negative test is 1 minus this, or 0.009. In patients who don't have the disease, the probability of a negative test is known as the specificity, and this is 0.996. Then similarly, the probability of a positive test among these patients is 1 minus this, which is 0.004. So just like last time, I can now calculate the joint probabilities for each of the four outcomes. Again, I'm just multiplying this probability by this probability. But if I want to address the question again, what is the probability that a patient has a disease given that they have a positive test result, I need to flip the order of the tree again. So just like last time now, the test results are going to go first. So a patient can either have a positive or a negative test result, and then they can either have the disease or not. So just like last time, we want to first start by filling out the right-hand side of the tree, and then we're going to go through and fill it out from left to right. So once again, the value at the top of the tree is the probability of a positive test and disease. This is again equivalent to the probability of disease and a positive test, which is this number, 0.3964. Same thing for the bottom branch, 0.5976. This is the same number as over here. And then again, the two middle branches flip. So 0.0036 goes here, and 0.0024 goes here. So now I have the joint probabilities at the end of the tree, and I want to go through and fill out the rest of the tree. So in order to get this number, I just add these two numbers at the end of the tree, 0.3964 and 0.0024. This is equivalent to 0.3988. And similarly, the bottom branch is 0.6012. And I should again verify that these sum to 1, which they do. The next step is to calculate these conditional probabilities. So again, let's call this probability Y. I know that 0.3988 times Y has to equal 0.3964. Then I can just solve for Y. Again, this is 0.3964. divided by 0.3988, which comes out to be 0.9940. And I can similarly fill in the rest of the tree. So what we observe in this case now is that a patient who has a positive test result has a 99.4% chance of actually having the disease. So just to summarize, what we found in South Africa, we had a prior probability belief of 40% that a randomly selected person in the population has HIV. If this patient then observes a positive test result, we then update our beliefs to over 99% probability. So again, we use Bayes' rule to update our prior probability, which is of 40%, to a posterior probability of over 99.4%. So this is in contrast to the United States, where we only had a 1% chance of HIV prevalence and observed a positive test result, those patients only have a 72% chance of actually having HIV. So the second key takeaway of Bayesian analysis is that both background prevalence as well as the test characteristics and by this I mean both sensitivity and specificity matter in determining the posterior probability of having the disease. In these examples, the test characteristics were identical. So sensitivity and specificity was exactly the same. The only thing that differed was background prevalence was 40% instead of 1%. Let's return to the United States, where average HIV prevalence in the US is less than 1%. Let's suppose that we test 10,000 people in the population for HIV. So this 2x2 matrix will show that there are four possible buckets that these 10,000 people can fall into. So they can, each person can either have the disease or not have the disease. And they can either have a positive test or a negative test. Using the probability tree that we just calculated, I can show the number of people that will fall into each one of these buckets. Approximately 99 people will have the disease and have a positive test result. This is referred to as the number of true positives in the population. Conversely, about 9,860 people will not have the disease and will also have a negative test. And this is referred to as the number of true negatives in the population. In this compartment, about one person who has the disease will have a negative test. This is referred to as a false negative. And similarly, about 40 people will not have the disease but will end up with a positive test result. And this is what's referred to as the false positive rate. There's a total of 41 people in this example who would receive a wrong diagnosis. We would have one person who actually has a disease but thinks that they don't, and so that poses a risk to the population because they're walking around, they don't realize they have the disease even though they do. And then conversely, we have 40 people who actually don't have the disease but received a positive test result. So they're walking around thinking they actually have HIV when in fact they don't. And oftentimes these people will be diagnosed at a later stage and found to not have HIV. So in general with HIV testing, we usually think of doing a sequence of tests. So I've just demonstrated one particular test, which is either positive or negative. But in practice, with HIV testing, there's a sequence of testing. And the basic idea is the rapid test will catch pretty much everyone with HIV, but it's also gonna pick up a bunch of people who don't have HIV. So we think of this, what I've circled here is the total population that will test positive with the rapid test. We see that 99 of these people actually have the disease and 40 people don't have the disease. So what will typically happen is all of these people will undergo a second test, which is known as a Western blot. And the purpose of the Western blot is to exclude the people who don't have the disease but end up with a positive test. So the third sort of key takeaway from this sort of analysis with regard to HIV is when we do a sequence of tests, we want to start with a test that has high sensitivity because it'll cast a wide net, meaning that it'll detect everyone who has HIV, as well as a number of people who don't have HIV. The follow-up test will have a high specificity, and the purpose of that is to rule out all of the people who are actually false positives. So the third sort of takeaway is a test with high sensitivity is used to cast a wide net. But then in addition to this, we want to do a test that has a high specificity And the purpose of this is, again, to rule out all of the false positives.